student and non-student organizations here at Ryerson. I just want to do a small shout out to them. So we've got the Ryerson Corporate Social Responsibility Student Association, which we have several members located around here. Any of you who are interested in joining the Ryerson CSR Student Association, please make that known at some point during the day. We've got the Ryerson Commerce and Government Association, RCGA. We have members from that as well, wherever they are. And we've got the Ryerson Law Center, which is a Ryerson University center here. We've got the Department of Law and Business. We also have representatives from the Law and Business Students Association here as well. Basically, we have a number of organizations here at Ryerson that are all co-sponsoring this event. Actually, one of the professors here, Chris McDonald, has presented, and Chris is the director of the Leaders...
The Ted Rogers Leadership Center and the Jim Patterson Ethical Leadership Program.
Better said by him. And also someone who is spearheading a lot of superb events here at Ryerson. I do want to mention that this is the first of a five-part series by Herschel. Anyone who is not on the Ryerson CSR Institute mailing list and who would like to be should certainly get back to me at some point during the event today. I'd be happy to put you on. But in addition to the five-part series by Herschel, there are a number of other events coming up. There's an event coming up next week on anti-corruption. We have Frank Vogel coming in. He's author of a book on fighting corruption and a leader in the Transparency International movement. We've got Herschel's next second part of the series. He's going to be speaking on the 9th regarding law as an escape valve. We've got someone coming in from the White Ribbon Organization speaking about how they are working with mining companies to address gender-related challenges associated with the mining sector. There's a partnership coming up, event coming up with the Federal Extractive Sector CSR Counselor on dispute resolution in the mining industry, and so on, just to give you a small smattering of an indication of some of the events coming up. As I say, those are in addition to events carried out by a number of other fine organizations here at Ryerson University. So thank you for coming, and I do hope you will connect in with some of these other events. I want to talk just briefly about Herschel. We're extremely fortunate to have him as a distinguished professor because he really represents sort of a person that can really complement the conventional pure people who come up through the academic stream. He's somebody who's had a lot of practical experience, both in government and in the private sector. And from the moment that I first started to talk to him, which was earlier in the summer, what was really apparent is he not only has had a lot of practical experience, he's had a lot of fun. And he's had, in the course of that, he's accumulated a lot of great stories. As I said to some of you, stories is one of the best ways of making a point, as opposed to just trying to make an argument to you. A story oftentimes will make the point, but it'll make the point in a way which sort of captures your imagination and brings you in much, much better than just kind of a dump of information. And very apparent from the moment I first started doing commercial, that he just got a trundle of stories from all of his various work. So just to mention a few things that he's done. He's been the CEO of Speedy Muffler. He has been the CEO of public affairs and strategic communications firm called GPC International. He's been the head of corporate and public affairs at Wolfson's Companies, and he's currently the managing director of Tipping Point Solutions, which is a social media advocacy consultancy. And he's also head of national communications, not too surprisingly, keenly involved in national communications. In addition to that, on the government side, he has worked in the PMO's office as part of the team, the PCO's office, Privy Council office of the Prime Minister, Trudeau at the time, He served as Deputy Minister to Ontario Premier David Peterson. So, in short, this is a man who straddles both the business and the government community, and in particular, has focused all of his attention on communications, really kind of realized sort of the significance, the centrality of communications for the effectiveness of anything, whether you're in business or you're in government. So, my feeling is that the whole issue of social media is essentially kind of the latest wave in how communications can take place, be it between government and its stakeholders, or business and its stakeholders, or indeed between government and business. And it represents an area where there's unique challenges and unique opportunities. And I just can't think of a better person than Herschel to speak on that. So what I'm going to do now is hand over the baton to Herschel.
Now, I start with a very a simple premise. And the premise, as Kernahan properly said, is that social media is here to stay. I'm not saying that your laptop, your tablet, your iPad, they may all be gone, and it'll all be glasses or bracelets or some other manner of doing this. I mean, after all, I've lived through the 8-track tape recorder. I've lived through, you know, VHS and Beta and even other creations, CDs, things that anymore you download your computer. But nonetheless, the basic content is still there, and the way of being able to communicate is still there, even if the methodology, some of the methodologies change along the road. And I'm going to look at four or five different things, and I'm going to try to use a lot of case studies because, frankly, not only are some, I couldn't make these up. The point about some of these is it's beyond belief that these things have happened. But having said that, I'm really not trying to concentrate very much on the content of these issues. I'm much more interested in trying to look at how social media affects the way the issues are handled, whether by a corporation, a government, or the media itself. Because social media, in a very, let me make a bold, dramatic, and I'll probably regret saying this later, statement, social media has even changed the way that news is gathered. And so, as a result, the profound effect, the ripple effect of social media is so great that we can look at this through a number of different prisms. We can look at it also through areas like crisis management, for example. In the old days when I was working for a living and selling my services around the world, GTC International was a company we had. We were one of the largest public affairs companies in the world. We had about 750 full-time consultants working in 19 countries. So I had, at the time, maybe 50 full-time consultants sitting in Brussels at the European Union, inventing ways to make them crazy while they made us crazy on behalf of our client. We'll leave that aside. But what was interesting in this whole exercise of what we were doing is we were almost in a pre-social media era. If we had only had social media to do much of the pressuring and the advocacy that we would have liked to have been able to do, and we had to find the old-fashioned ways of doing it, you know, letter writing, having people sign petitions. I mean, you can do that online too, but we didn't have the capacity that exists now. Now, I want to suggest to you that there are certain basics in all of this. Social media is not a passing fad, said that already. But the reason it makes a difference, I'm going to give you a list, and I'm going to then take all my case studies and try to show you how some of these points actually play out. First of all, the speed of social media, the ability for all of us to talk to each other, to talk to government, business, and to anyone else. We're at hyper warp speed. This is truly the situation of Star Trek and beyond. And we never had that before. But it's not just that. It absolutely collapses the decision-making time on the other side, which leads to massive potential mistakes, lacks of judgment, the inability to really argue out options, and many other things that can happen as a consequence. The viral nature of social media, you're all well aware of. And just like you can catch an infection, but let me tell you, lots of politicians and lots of corporations have caught very unhealthy bugs because of the social media impact. One of the most profound impacts, however, of social media is the actual empowerment and engagement of individual citizens like yourselves. We now see the rise, and journalists hate this, the rise of the citizen journalist who says, why bother going to Ryerson School of Journalism? Why bother going through a rigorous program of understanding what makes news or not? I have a camera on my phone. I have the ability to inform the world about what I saw or what I saw. I have the ability to inform as many people as I can about what is happening. And this is a profound difference because in some ways, major media today play catch-up to what they are being told by some of these citizen journalists who are actually generating the agenda that we used to reserve to the CBC and the Globe and Mail. And that isn't the way it happens anymore. One of the most profound impacts, of course, that social media has is that it removes the filters, the authority figures, whether it's the media, politicians, others. It just removes them from the ability to filter and define and suggest what is important and what is not. It's leveled the playing field quite profoundly. Now, most of the major players have accepted governments, corporations, other institutions, not-for-profits, that this ultimate reality that social media is making a difference. And now, what I'd like to also look at with you today in a little while is how they try to accommodate it, how they live with it, how they respond to it, and how they try, sometimes quite imperfectly, to manage social media and the impact that it has. Now, there are some other features of social media that I would be remiss if I didn't talk about. First of all is the emotional quality that it seems to be able to unleash. I have never been in a more uncivil place than in reading the blog posts or the responses that often come to any article on any subject. The scum just rises to the top, you know, and out they come with a series of attacks followed by others who attack them for being idiots and morons, and that's the most polite thing that you'll hear and read. And if these are moderated conversations, and they supposedly are, God knows what they've eliminated from the list of what they have. But the emotion is there. There is a perception of transparency. You know, we all belong to the social media world in which I can say what I think, and you can say what you think, but I also have the advantage of, for me, being called Gerza, which means I have some level of anonymity in terms of saying what I really think. And there are lots of, you know, Space Cadet 1 and Evildoer 4 and any number of others who are out there using the cloak of anonymity to keep piling the wood on the fire and throwing the oil on the fire. So all of that happens. Now, you can't make this stuff up, but what are people thinking? This is this morning's Toronto Star. I know, and this story was repeated in the papers. City worker on Facebook derides cyclists. I'm just quoting this. I hate bikes because they are reckless, put me at risk, and they try to bully. Don't worry. Some big changes have come to the Highway Traffic Act, where we can now suspend service. I'm having a private conversation with someone. I'm not interested in commenting to you, the media, about what I said. Okay. I rest my case. Because all this is about clout say whatever they want. You can challenge accuracy. You can promote and validate rumors. Oh, do I have stories about rumors that have been created on the internet with not one figment of truth whatsoever. But having said that, I have to give the social media world credit because it actually does have a self-correcting feature. And enough people will get in on the other side and pile on. And there are some interesting studies in Asia which actually show that you can have a neutralizing effect on some of these rumors if you have enough time. The trouble is, often, and this is particularly true for corporations, a little less true for governments who are so sensitive to this stuff, if you don't follow the argument, by the time you actually get involved in trying to counter it, it's too late. Because it's like a cocktail conversation. If you're involved in a social media discussion, it's a cocktail conversation. You're talking to somebody. You and I are talking right now. We're going to have we're messaging back and forth. And then you're going to say to me at some point, well, you know, you've repeated yourself four times. I'm really not interested in anything else you have to say on the subject. I'm going to go and talk to someone else because maybe they have something more interesting to say than you. So the whole way that government spokespeople and corporate spokespeople with the three messages and you stay on target, all of that has been basically blown apart by what happens in social media. So if you think about some of these specific points, as I'm going through the case studies, and I'll try to highlight them again, let's just talk about how social media, first of all, has changed news coverage. Now, the first way is it's changed what we deem to be news. In the ancient times, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, editors sat around. You ever see there are movies about this? Editors sit around the table, and they all opine on stories that people are working on, and things they think that are important. Now, in the 2-minute cycle of social media, you have a set of stories that start to, quote, trend. And when they trend, they create pressure in the system, in the media system, to decide whether or not this place should be a place that we allocate news resources. And remember, there are two finite issues here. One is there are much greater availability of news sources to be able to choose from, and there are fewer news resources to report on. These are the two givens in this business. And the consequence of this is that even the New York Times today, the Associated Press today, use TrendSpotter, use different social media applications to decide which stories are trending and therefore make their own informed discussions and decisions on which stories they'll be involved. It's a profound difference than when four men and maybe one woman used to sit around a table and make a decision about the kinds of stories that were going to be looked at. Now, how is information collected these days in the media? Crowdsourcing anyone? You put out the appeal. You ask. I mean, the terrible tragedy in Newton, where the children in the school were murdered. And there they are, the bloggers and the social media types are all out crowdsourcing information from people all around in order to be able to put a picture together, because in this world, as in all the media world, getting it first is the most important thing, and getting it right is a secondary, desirable, but secondary issue. And so they crowdsourced to as many people as possible. And you know what happened? They identified the brother of the shooter as the shooter originally because they got it wrong. And they had all kinds
kinds of other mistakes that were made, but we were given the information first, even if it was the wrong information, which is an interesting way of doing business. Now, I've talked to you about the rise of citizen journalists, and I it's a bit of an oxymoron, because there's no discipline in doing this. And we have great debates now. There's a new book that's just out about a young woman who went through a horrific experience in Africa, where she was a person without formal media training, but decided that she was going to blog and write about what was going on in some of the crisis areas there, and she was captured, tortured, raped. I mean, it's just horrific. And so the media say, some have been very critical of her because she wasn't a professional media person, so this wouldn't have happened if she hadn't been so naive and so foolish and all the rest. Interestingly, the person who has come to her greatest defense is the journalist professional who was supposed to have been the target of the kidnapping, who was sold out by his media fixer, but who got sick that day and didn't go on the trip, so she was plan B. So there's more than one side of the story. That's all I would say. Now, in a news cycle, there's no opportunity anymore. I mean, it's true in general, but it's even more true with social media. How do you do fact-checking? How do you do accuracy checking? How do you do all of this when you move from basically a situation where you used to have one or two formal deadlines a day into having a news deadline every 10 minutes? You know, if any journalist that you know that you want to follow, you can follow them, and they're tweeting because they can't wait for the next cycle on the media that they're on, and they have to prove they're on top of the story. It creates enormous pressure. I'm not saying these are bad people. I'm not saying they don't want to get it right. What I'm saying is the consequences of the social media system in terms of this play out not just through the media, but frankly, it plays out in terms of governments, and it plays out in terms of corporations and not-for-profits and associations. And so that accessibility. So I want to start, and I'm going to have a lot of these examples. Probably all know who Chuck Hagel is. If you don't, he's the Secretary of Defense of the United States. He was appointed at the start of President Obama's second term. I'm not making this stuff up. This I'm just going to read to you. You'll understand why I'm saying I couldn't make this up. But this is the power of social media. There's a reporter at the New York Daily News whose name is Dan Friedman. And he knew that in the confirmation hearings that Chuck Hagel was going to go through, there were going to be a number of tough questions about Mr. Hagel's alleged hostility to Israel when he was a senator. He asked a lot of tough questions. He was very tough on Iran and Iranian policy vis-a-vis the government. He was just a contrarian. Maybe you want to put it that way. So Friedman decided to ask a source the following question. Has Chuck Hagel given a speech to the Junior League of French Hezbollah? Got that? The Junior League of French Hezbollah, assuming that Hezbollah has a junior league, but none. He also said, has he ever spoken to the European friends of Hamas? Friedman said. Now, he admits, these were just me over-the-top hyperbole. Don't worry, we're in an age of social media. One day after he asked the question, Breitbart.com, which is a conservative website in the United States, inflated the story, or the non-story, into the great big bubble of something under the headline, Secret Hegel donors, ? White House spokesman ducks the questions on the European Friends of Hamas and on the Junior League of Hezbollah. The Breitbart piece, which was authored by someone, sparked a whole pylon, conflating layers of nothing in the days that followed. Governor Mike Huckabee, now this is a guy who ran for president of the United States, did not win, but nonetheless he ran. Huckabee said, if rumors of Chuck Hagel having received funds from the European Friends of Hamas, would it prove fully disqualify him from being the Secretary of State? Unquote. Goes on. Friedman, the journalist of the New York Daily News, who had realized that he was probably the guy that they had based the story on, went to the blog and said, look, maybe I made a mistake. Probably should have said more than that, but he said, maybe I made a mistake. But truthfully, there is no proof of any of these things. Shapiro, who was the blogger, said the following. The story as reported is correct. Whether the information I was given by the source is correct, I have no ability to verify. In other words, this story's going on and it doesn't matter, whatever you say. And so, if, as Friedman said, if anyone doesn't already know, partisan agendas, social media reporting, and old-fashioned carelessness can move complete crocks of crap really fast in social media. If you see a story on Hagel addressing the Junior League of French Hezbollah, please understand that that's fake, too. Now, I'm using it as an example because this is something that no one even bothered to check, but it already became and had a life of its own, thanks to social media. Now, social media often makes commentaries on things that haven't happened. I mean, Gabby Giffords, the U.S. Congresswoman, former U.S. Congresswoman, who was shot in Arizona, you know, we all read when she died. But we all read when she died because it was reported fully, started with social media, picked up by the national media, repeated by everyone else. There were some lovely tributes. But the point about all of this is that social media drove an agenda that no one had the time to check. That's my point. Because the passion to be first and get it makes getting it right secondary. Just leave it at that because we can do a lot more talking with Mr. Harper in the Prime Minister's office. Now has a full-time unit, does nothing but monitor social media. This is the new poll. This isn't about, you know, we used to count, when I was in college, we used to count the number of letters that we would get. Letters, you know, snail mail, I mean, does anybody, maybe you've heard of it at least. The thing is, that's not what they do anymore. They count the number of trending stories in social media, and they monitor it every 15 minutes. So, if you ever wondered why they do it, it's really very simple. First of all, it gives them an instantaneous read, an insight into stakeholders' preoccupations. And attitudes. Secondly, they can use the data because of programs that exist and will be used in my business, that you can segment the hard and soft core, who's driving a story, who's influencing it, who's basically just repeating it, which segments of the country are most affected. They get all that information out of this. The third is that by going through the social media material, they can find the language that will allow them to shape the messages that their own spokespeople
will then use so that they can be speaking back to you the way that you have will be most receptive. And they also find it obviously a tool, a two-way tool to communicate back to influencers and dialogue on issues that matter to them. And finally, there's a wonderful opportunity. There are two words that I love to use in talking about social media. The first word is engagement, and the second is fulfillment. Because that's really what social media is best at, engaging people and then asking them to do something, asking them to fulfill. And it's more than a Facebook like, and it's more it might be signing a petition, it might be going to a meeting, it might be any number of other things. But it's the ability to motivate people and to get engagement and fulfillment. That's why governments care, and that's what they're using it for. And by the way, that's exactly what corporations are doing, mirror image against government. They're doing the exact same thing and trying to force and advocate in that way. So let me use a couple of specific examples to just show you where stories go and where they don't go. A couple of years ago, the Harper government decided to get rid of the long-form census. Some of you may remember that. The long-form census, which only existed for many decades, was a very valuable tool for social scientists to be able to measure trends in the country. It was very detailed, and because by law, you actually had to fill it in, and most people did it anyways, but with a few recalcitrants, they got them to fill it in, it meant that you had very, very rich data sets. So you really had the ability to shape public policy. Okay? They didn't like it. I'm not going to make an argument about whether they're right or wrong. It's not the point. My point is, why did they not succumb to the blow of Globe and Mail editorial after editorial, or Toronto Star editorial after editorial, the Sun, of course, supported them. But why didn't they succumb to any of that? Well, the simple answer is, when I spoke to people in the Prime Minister's office, and to people who knew people in the Prime Minister's office, they got, in a six-month period, about 7,500 social media messages of any interest. Compare that to the CRTC, which was musing about heavying up the costs to regular users of internet broadband and saying that there might be a policy change and it might cost more if you use more of this broadband. And when the Prime Minister's office got 480,000, let me repeat the number, 480,000 messages in 3 days. Guess what? The minister stood up and said, I don't know what the CRTC is talking about. We're not considering a policy like that. Compare the 480,000 to the 7,500 over a six-month period. And you still understand now why the long-form census not only dead, but fully buried, because they knew that the public that they cared about wasn't being emotionally engaged in terms of this. Another example from the federal government. Do you remember the throne speech that said they were going to change the words of O Canada? How many messages do you think they got in the first 2 days? And then all of a sudden, never heard about it again. Have you ever heard about it again? No one's ever heard about it again. Because this is a perfect example where they measured and used social media in order to be able to take the message. Now, social media can be a very powerful tool for not-for-profits and associations, and I want to use an example for you. Do you remember Idle No More? Aboriginal group, but not just the Aboriginal group, that wanted to stop the Harper government from passing legislation that eroded the treaty rights
of Aboriginal groups. There's the Navigation Act, there's Environmental Assessment Act, there's a whole series of other things. How did this start? This is the power of social media. How did it start? Four women in Saskatchewan emailed Chuck, decided that they wanted to do something about this. They got a hold of some of their friends, and they had four public meetings in North Battleford, Saskatchewan, and in Prince Albert, and in a couple of other places. And within 1 month, with no money, with no institutional backing, the First Nations Assembly weren't behind them at the beginning, they had a national movement. And that is the power of social media when it emotionally strikes a chord and people want to get involved. They had been angered by a lack of consultation, and damn it, they were going to do something about it. I mean, other examples of this include the Occupy movement. You could look at the pipeline issues, Keystone and the Northern Gateway, and look at the killing that's going on. I mean, it's absolute slaughter in social media against the pipeline companies and the groups who are in the heavy oil and oil sands. I'm not supposed to say tar sands. Oil sands business. I have to tell you, this is just a matter of public record. I used to be on the board of Suncorp. So I understand. I've flown in a helicopter over and looked at the tailing ponds and all the rest of this, and I know both sides of the story pretty well. But I can tell you, there is no story that's really been generated by the pro-development people, but there's a hell of a story that's been developed all around the world, not just in Canada, but frankly coming from Britain and coming from Europe and coming from other groups, all about these issues. And that's another feature of the internet. It knows, and social media, it knows no national boundaries. They make no difference whatsoever. Because of time, I'm just going to move ahead to that's brand, whose market capitalization, whose revenue, whose supply chain, or any other business value that you can attribute to them, can be affected by stakeholder actions, is newly vulnerable to what can happen by the power of social media. And social media basically has fundamentally changed the way corporations act. They have to change their internal decision making. Now think about this. The people who generally occupy the corner office, the C-suite as they call it, who are they? Well, they've got usually they're men still. Usually they've got gray hair. They get their kids to change to 12 on the computer or wherever else that they have. You know, I mean, they just don't have a lot of technical skills. They're the ones who are now being asked to make fundamental decisions in warp speed time, which they're not comfortable making, based on the analysis of $45,000 a year technowonks who are sitting there doing social media analysis. This is not a good formula for decision making in terms of a corporation. So some of my clients and others, they've now created a SMART, which is a social media action response team, which is cross-disciplinary and involves people from different groups, because you've got to change the decision making process within a corporation if you're going to properly deal with social media, and it's really important. Now, you know, I was talking to a professor here who were just before we started, and I said I was going to use as an example Canadian Bank, which is a very, very good institution, but which had a bit of a problem recently. And you know, I'm using social media. Remember, I'm not talking about the content of the decision that they made. It may have been stupid, but that's separate. We're
we're talking about the way that social media impacted the decision. So, you know, just to be fair, I actually have an account at the Royal Bank of Canada, so this is all transparency, right? You know, the days of social media. So I actually bank there. And I know that they decided to have, it's called outsourcing, some functions that used to be done in Canada to a company in India, if you recall this. And the interesting part of this is they asked the employees whose jobs were going to be lost if they would train the people who were going to be replacing them. Right. Okay, I'm leaving the content aside now. I'm just going to say, you know, in an era when people are all worried about their own jobs and what's going to happen to them, this is not necessarily the world's best situation. But I'm interested, frankly, in how they handled it, not so much what the issue is. First of all, they did, it doesn't appear, there were, this issue went on for days and days and days in terms of social media, which was driving the newspaper and television headlines, which was absolutely like they were creating online petitions, they were getting people involved across the country. They were doing things, and the bank was like a super tanker going in the water, and it just didn't move. But it's almost as if, and I said this, I actually said this to them, as someone, that, you know, it'd be nice if you had some real-time predictive tracking tools for social media, so you'd know, you'd think, when something was happening that was actually impacting you, and therefore you could make better decisions. Ah, but we're communicating. We're buying full-page ads in the newspapers, which fewer people are reading. I also have to declare I used to be on the board of Torstar, so I understand that fewer and fewer people are reading newspapers in general. But we're buying full-page ads. What the heck were you doing in social media? How were you selling your story there? And how were you selling it in a timely fashion? And how could you just decide when you were ready to make a comment, as opposed to being a full participant in the debate that was going on, when you might actually have impacted the story? I guess we have to bank with one of the five of them, so, you know, that's the way life is. But the point of all of this is that they were not able to deal with something that was really quite straightforward. It was a terrible problem, but it was a very straightforward problem about some of the things that they could have done. A second example. Yes?
Do you think that's because they don't take social media serious enough, or the people in the leadership positions are not savvy using social media enough to understand the role that it could play in communication?
That's what I was trying to get at. I think the latter, that it's very hard in organizations where the leadership has basically grown up with a different model to really understand how the world is changing. And these are huge bureaucracies. You know, these are companies that have 60, 70,000 employees, and they're huge bureaucracies. So it's very difficult. And then it's difficult when you're relying on junior people who are analyzing this stuff to say to you, you got to change everything you're doing, you know, and, you know, I know you made $10 million last year, but you got to change what you're doing, and I only need $45,000, but you really don't know what you're doing here right now. It's a cultural thing. Yeah. At least I think so. But I'm always to be prepared to be given $10 million, and then I'll tell you how the world is. The second example is DriveClean. You know this program? It's Ontario government, 35 jurisdictions in North America. They clean, you know, you get your cars tested. Sometimes the system doesn't work so well, but they still take out something like 36% of pollutants that are smog causing, and that have major campaign that's being run against it right now is all the social media. It's not a public campaign. It's a campaign targeting politicians, targeting media, and it's all through social media. Because social media gives you the David and Goliath effect. I'm going to use an example that I'm using right now. I think they're called YoPro Treats. Anybody know it? Well, anyways, it's a company that used to sell a particular probiotic yogurt at Loblaws. And they didn't like the way they were being given shelf position, and they really didn't like when Loblaws decided to make a President's Choice product of a similar nature. And so they went onto YouTube and did a 4-minute piece about how live up to your obligations, Galen Weston Jr., and all the rest. And they got more attention and a little more impact than writing letters to the president saying, you know, please pay attention to us. They took their case public, and because social media is such a cost-effective way of doing it, they were able to get that message across. Now, do you remember the case of the U.S. airline that smashed someone's guitar? There's a great social media example of how that smashed guitar cost that airline a lot of money because they didn't respond properly, and then they just got punished through social media by everybody who was doing it. But let me use a couple of other examples. These are just delicious. Subway. You know the Subway story? Subway said that they sell a foot-long sandwich. Somebody in Australia took a tape measure with a smart camera and measured an 11-inch sandwich, put it up on social media, and within 3 days had class action lawsuits all across the United States and in many other countries all about Subway, which then stupidly said, footlong is sort of a cultural descriptive of what the sandwich is like and not a specific, you know, statement. Perfect example of where a company operating in another jurisdiction all of a sudden found its brand and its credibility under attack using social media around the world and was too slow in terms of responding. Because then contests. People were all going into their local Subway with their tape measures and they were posting pictures on their hashtags and that's what they were doing. It was great fun and boy, it hurt them. Another example. Applebee's. Does anybody know Applebee's? It's an American example. But Applebee's is one of these less than fine dining restaurants where you can go in and get a meal. I can't leave this up. But it shows you how dangerous social media can become in the hands of morons. The pastor of a St. Louis-based church, Truth in the World Deliverance Ministries, now you knew it was going to be trouble as soon as you heard that, but Truth in the World Deliverance Ministries took some members of her congregation to an Applebee's after an evening service. The receipt for the meal added 18% as a gratuity, which is the restaurant's policy for Gardens Day or more. The minister wrote a note on the bottom of the receipt. Why should I give you 18% when the Lord only asks for 10%? Okay? Now, the waiter, who had a smartphone, took a picture of the minister and of the receipt. And because it was a credit card thing with their credit card details and their
And so we had all this going on, and you just say to yourself, how stupid can people be? But this is the power of a social media capability to be able to make a story national in character and to get a brand that's in real trouble. Now, a couple of just my favorites. Some marketing geniuses, you know, we used to, a lot of people think of social media because they think of it as a marketing tool, which it, of course it is, but it's not just a marketing tool. Think about this. McDonald's. Remember they launched hashtag McDStories, asking people to tell you good stories about your first Happy Meal? Or Mountain Dew had a new soda naming contest with a hashtag, Mountain Dew. Cheerios came up with the idea to have a campaign to share the memories of Cheerios. Each one of these became hashtags. And what they did is people from around the world, for all kinds of different reasons, used the opportunity of social media to attack what the institution was doing. And not because we're talking through the program of corporate social responsibility, I particularly want to use the Cheerios one. Because the Cheerios one, what happened was there became an organized campaign by people who were protesting genetically modified foods and products to be able to attack the Cheerios owners for their programs in other places. A perfect example. Another example that was going on at the same time, in Mountain Dew, they started a campaign which was, they called it, they wanted a name for the drink, so somebody thought it was quite cute and they developed the name Diabetes. And so this became a campaign in social media. I'm just giving you examples because I can show you how this affects brands and affects other things.
Herschel?
Yes?
Can I ask you, because you brought up McDonald's and brought up corporate responsibility. I'm very interested to hear your thoughts regarding the McDonald's campaign where they basically said, bring it, ask your question regarding our food, you know. You say that we do this horrible thing and there's no actual chicken in the chicken, or whatever it is, that which is a Canadian
right.
McDonald's campaign there. Now, clearly, McDonald's is extremely astute corporate actor in terms of communications. What was your thoughts about that one?
I don't have a problem, even with the campaigns that they ran. What I have a problem with is that they haven't thought through what's their plan B if somebody either tries to hijack what you're doing and how you're going to respond. And that's where the dilemma is. And that's really, for me, looking at it from a social media perspective, that you got to understand the qualities, the characteristics, and then know what you're going to do, which is a very nice lead-in, if you don't mind, into just a few words that I just want to say about crisis management.
Could I just add something to the McDonald's?
Yeah, please. Go ahead.
The person who knocked on the door that resulted in saving those three girls that was kidnapped in the States. When he was interviewed, he kept saying, I was just eating my McDonald's. And that just kept playing. So that goes viral. The McDonald's tweeted to him, like, you know, we'll be in touch. So I'm like, everyone's watching this hashtag or watching the McDonald's account, like, what are they going to do, right? Like, and then I saw people started criticizing McDonald's because they didn't do anything. But, I mean, it's only been like 2 days since I... You know,
but that's the nature of expectations, and that's exactly the point. And the other side of it is there'll be other people who will criticize McDonald's for taking advantage of a situation like this. They had already won when they got their name mentioned so many times. They could have done something privately with the individual and then said what they said or say nothing. Yes.
Sir, I'm pretty sure they gave him three Big Macs for a year.
That's
what I heard.
bacteria. I mean, we go through a list, but the point is you knew that some kind of contamination of your food, it was some problem that you had. If you were a transportation company, God forbid, what was the worst thing that could happen? An airline crash, you know, I mean, a tanker explosion. I mean, you know what it's going to be. You just don't know when it's going to happen. So the whole thesis and the whole idea was being able to say, I've got a plan in place for the first 3 hours. Because after that, things change. But at least I know that I can assemble my senior management, I can assemble my crisis management team, I can get everybody working together. And we have a plan, we have ideas, and we played out some scenarios. It doesn't work that way when you have social media. Because when they were lacking, like I'll take that terrible tragedy here in Canada, second that somebody showed up with their cell phone and started sending the pictures, the 3 hours had evaporated for that company, and everybody had to be dealing, and that's true, by the way, for the governments who then had to respond, for anybody else who had to respond, because it was instant. There was no more, I have a little time to get my Exxon Valdez cleanup team in place, or my BP team cleanup team in place. You have no time, because people are watching the oil or the explosions happening in real time. And that is a tremendous difference. And so you don't have the luxury of 3 hours because of the virality of stories on social media, because of the speed with which things are being seen. And frankly, you accelerate the speed of decision making, and that is generally only one thing. An accelerated decision making process is not usually a good one. And because there are too many variables that happen. Now, you need proper monitoring tools across platforms. And some of the traditional ones, which are very good tools, but they're historical, like Salesforce, Radian6, or Sysmos, or stuff like that, they're not going to give you real-time predictive information. And your attacks can come from anywhere. They don't even have to come from within the country, but they can be picked up within the country, and they can be run. So you just can't repeat your three messages. You become irrelevant. And this is where the other, remember I said that you have a cultural issue with the corporation. But now I'm going to give you one other example. Some of you have heard of lawyers. In any crisis management situation, you have the lawyers, the financial people, and the public affairs people. They never agree. Ever. Why? Because the lawyers never admit guilt, because we're going to pay for it. The accounting people are already, and the financial people are trying to figure out the consequences for friends and all the rest, and the public affairs people are saying, being upfront, being transparent, taking responsibility when you have to, is the best way for us to get through all of this. That is a natural tension. I'm not saying anybody's doing wrong. I'm just saying it's a natural tension that exists within a company. Look, I didn't mean to talk about this, but I'm going to use an example that I was involved in. When I was in the Wilson Companies Limited, we owned 4 different lines of business. We had the best hockey team in the world, sorry, Toronto. We had the best beer in Canada, Molson's. We had a cleaning and sanitizing business, which was called Diversity. I want to talk about Diversity for a second. Some of you may not know the name, but Diversity had cleaning. It was a cleaning and sanitizing chemical business, and we had plants all around the world. And one of our plants blew up. 2,000 degrees Celsius fireball. Blew up in Australia. Okay? And I was watching pictures from Australia saying that they wanted to, take the board of directors of Molson's and put them in jail.
wasn't quite as worried about that as the statement they wanted to take the chief environmental officer of Molson's and put him in jail. So I had some vested interest in the whole story. Let me tell you the rest of the story, because it's a very interesting one. It doesn't deal with social media, but if social media had existed then, it would have been a real problem for us. Weeks later, we discovered why the plant exploded. There was a fire in the plant. Every chemical plant has a plan for how you deal with fires in it. What kind of fire retardants you use, how they're applied, and whatever happens. In this case, the wrong fire brigade came to the plant to put out a small localized fire, and they used the wrong retardants. Well, I was off the hook, board of directors was off the hook, a lot of other people were off the hook, a lot of costs, insurance issues, and all the rest. But the point about this is, when you're in the middle of a crisis, you don't have time to have some long discussion about what actually happened. And what if we had, quote, taken responsibility? And what if we had, you go through all of these things. So these are some of the issues that you have to do. Now, I could talk a lot more, but maybe I should just stop right now and just say, we've got about 20 minutes. Some of you have asked questions through, but I'm happy to answer more questions, and if not, I'll meet up my own and answer them. So don't worry about it. And
corporations in pressure to be proactive with certain aspects, knowing that if they do like faulty work, for example, that it would blow up in their face with social media.
Well, you would have thought that they would have known that anyways, no matter what they were involved in or how they were participating. But the bottom line is that social media makes it even a greater risk. And so I absolutely agree with you that it becomes a greater risk for them. It also matters what kind of social media. One of the things I didn't talk about, and I just have some numbers, is different social media appeal to different groups. For example, Facebook. I mean, this is not a quiz, that's a test, but I'm just curious if you know this. Facebook. How many of Facebook users are under the age of 25?
It's like a quick 25, 50, 75% sort of thing.
Oh, that's one answer. Anybody else?
17%?
Okay, 17.
I mean, how many are under?
How many are under 25 years of age, Facebook?
80%? About 80%, yeah.
80%?
I think it's around 65%.
65, okay. You're in the right direction, but you're not, the numbers aren't quite right. Is 40% of Facebook users are under the age of 25. So if you want to communicate with that target audience, obviously that's where you want to start. If you want to communicate with a Twitter audience, let's say between 26 and 44, how many people follow Twitter between those ages? 26 and 44. I'll give you the answer. The answer is almost 60%. So you understand which social media channel actually has the most opportunity to make an impact on your particular stakeholder group target audience. The same thing, if you're 55 plus, then it's interesting that LinkedIn is the most effective tool, but not by a lot. The numbers, I mean, it's a smaller cohort than this.
What would be any of that just LinkedIn?
LinkedIn has more people 55 plus than any of the others. But then, you can also look at this a different way. Look at it in terms of,
but this would just be like traditional media and, you know, channel phone.
Yeah.
It's not really local.
You have to, that's right.
Yeah.
And then the interesting thing, first of all, is that there's a kind of large line, spread out, things going on in the sense of no matter where something starts, for example, let's say it starts on Facebook, the virility, the viral killability of it, meaning it can catch fire and just cross all lines.
That's true. But on the other hand, you know that you at least want to start where you're targeted. Maintain over time what the numbers are.
Yeah.
The same thing goes for all of these about the male female ratio, which is really quite interesting because Facebook and Twitter are and Pinterest are much more skewed to women than Google Plus and LinkedIn and some of the others. Anyways, sorry, you were going to ask the question that I've got to you, Dr. Devin.
I guess this goes back to this question earlier, but one problem that I guess the city of Toronto kind of copes with a lot is our mayor and the sense of...
Who's that?
Rob Ford.
Oh, right.
And the sense of how social media is always buzzing around him in like a negative light.
Look, there are some politicians. I mean, Stephen Harper tweets about hockey. You know, I mean, but he's credible in that. I mean, to be fair to him, he's credible because everybody knows that he's a hockey nut. You know, and like written a book about it. He's very interested in hockey, so it makes it when you can talk about something. I don't know, maybe Mayor Ford will talk about certain other things. Famously associated with
that. Not only what he's talking about, it's like the tension that's...
Yeah, but the tension that's there is a tension that exists for other reasons. And I don't think that you can, you know, social media can amplify, sometimes it can create, but it can't do it all only by itself. So the question is, if he was more of a social media person, could he create a different persona for himself? Maybe, but I doubt it.
Yes. My question is just from the other side. Like being a company that is involved in one of these, you know, social media disasters for their own country, I feel like the memory of, you know, the social media users is so short, there's always another event to like catch on. So, you know, you hear about one thing, the Royal Bank, but, you know, 3 days later, there's something else. So, like, we're really moving quickly between the events. So, you know, everybody's talking about Royal Bank on day one, and then by day three, some other company's going to do, and then everybody's talking about that one. So, what's the long-term impact on a company that goes through one of these very, you know, viral events? You know, what's the kind of the course that runs out after that?
Well, they're tension.
Yeah,
the intention's bad, but I'm gonna make a different argument. I was reading a news story about something earlier this week, and it was still repeating from the morgue files about three issues with this particular organization from 4 years ago. So once you get labeled, my point is, you don't lose it. It's like, it's there. It's part of your corporate history. Now, how influential that is vis-a-vis everything else that you do, there'll be many other factors. But it's not something that disappears just because people's attention span is only for 3 days. It's there, and it's significant enough, it gets attached to the corporate history and the brand. And that, to me, is the issue of why it's important.
I was going to ask, from my knowledge, the first organizations that brought businesses to be accountable for their actions was non-government organizations. So now you're saying that social media, or now social media
Wildlife Fund, just to use an example, has run some very effective social media campaigns about the pipelines and about the oil tankers and stuff like that, and out in the West Coast of their Kennebec. So I think they've adapted them because, by definition, not-for-profit organizations don't have resources that are available sometimes to large corporations. So the internet, if I can go back to that David and Goliath analogy for a second, the internet and social media provide you with the opportunity to be actually able to compete in a marketplace where otherwise you couldn't afford to buy 10 pages of ads in the World Mail, the Toronto Star, or something like that. You couldn't do that. But you can, in terms of getting your message out on the internet quite effectively and through social media quite effectively.
But if we look at them in separate spheres, like the 1970s with just NGOs and like today with just social media, I feel like in the 70s they were more effective at getting everyone together for, maybe it's because there was less causes or something, and people had more of an attention span like we were talking about, but people were actually boycotting companies that used sweatshops and refusing to buy, like, yeah, clothing.
But all of them?
But now it's like, oh, like, 2012 is like all the rage, and then this like Paint the Night thing comes and like 10 people show up, you know? So I feel like social media is really effective in some ways, but then where is the, like, we need to sustain the
But I think you're asking a more profound question about the nature of millennials and Generation X's and Y's and boomers and what they put a value on and what they don't. I think it's as much that, because I think we just have so many more noise factors around us now, and it makes it difficult. But I understand the point you make, which is an important one. Yes.
With regards to CSR, and I'll use mining as an example, because that's the area I am, and using social media as a marketing tool to get messages out, what's the risk versus rewards of doing that, and how does, you know, a look at what we're doing turn into a bad thing? So what is better to say away?
You really have to understand your corporate goals and objectives before you get involved in a social media campaign. You cannot just say, this is an adjunct because social media is, you know, we have advertising and we have this and we have that. Now we're going to have a social media campaign. Because you've got to understand what your corporate goals are and whether social media will enhance them or create more risks for you. And that's an analysis that has to be done.
Have you
done
them? Is there any research out there?
I don't know about research. I mean, I have research for the companies we work with. And so I know that in some cases we tell them to go, and their focus is entirely on a very narrow stakeholder group. And we're not trying to tell the whole world. And it's like we've even created password protected groups where of influencers where you're only talking to people who you feel have a very real impact in terms of certain kinds of decisions that affect your company or affect your shared value or affect your environmental things. And there's any number of other ways of doing it. But you've got to be very, like, the danger of using social media is just assuming that it's just, you know, an add-on. And you just do it automatically because we do all the other things, we'll do it too. It's got to be really looked at. The most powerful message that came out of the Obama campaign in both 2008 and then subsequently in 2012 was how they use social media. And again, they used it very strategically. And they used it as it sat as a full partner in the decision-making process so that people understood exactly what it could do and what the risks were as well. And they didn't have it as just an add-on to some communications exercise that was three layers down. They sat as full members of the table making the decision. And I think that's the way that works best for whether it's a corporation or anything else. Yes, sir.
The Tylenol episode, if no one's familiar with it or needs a refresher, the Wikipedia article is actually, it's very good and it's very well sourced. Is there a model or an example or something that sort of gets it right? nowadays that you could point to?
Well, again, I have to separate out content from social media. The reason that, that Johnson & Johnson did it, was so effective in the Tylenol is because they did the right thing. They made good content decisions. They pull, I mean, just for those of you who may not know, they pull product off the shelf because they were worried about the safety of the product. They took immediate responsibility for doing things. People knew who was responsible. There was a face. It wasn't like the Exxon Valdez, where, this is again pre-social media days, where, you know, it took a week for the CEO, or the same thing happening with the VP, for the CEO to actually show up and to be seen to be taking an interest in what, whatever was happening. And so it's the content of that that is the key. And social media, as important as it is as the tools and mechanisms, isn't the content. It's the way of making sure that you get that information out. And to me, that's what the real importance is. If I was to use a specific example of somebody who's handled issues well in recent times, where I think Maple Leaf Foods did a pretty good job when they had that listeria crisis. They put the president of the company out. He was responsible immediately. We're doing this. This is what we're doing. This is how we're trying to track it down. But again, that's content. And then they made sure that everybody understood that. But that would be an example of that.
And I think this sort of linking of the content versus the role of social media is a really important point. I was thinking about the earlier question. Ian left, but Ian was the guy who was asking about for America and what difference social media would make. Think of Obama. And think of Ford. I know it's hard to think of the two at the same time. But they're both politicians. And if you don't mind me saying, I should say that Obama is a very astute politician. He's very careful with everything that he says. Very measured. He oftentimes responds very promptly. Remember when there was that person in Florida who was killed?
Right.
And, you know, his response was, you know, I have a son, I would be very concerned. But it was a very measured response. And I think the point that might be there is that if you are a smart person, then a new technology, social media being a new technology, if you use it smartly, can be a smart response. Mm-hmm. If you're not such a smart person, I'm not going to fill the blanks with who I might have in mind in that category, then social media probably is not going to be particularly good for you. So it's in a way, you could say social media is one of these things. If you know what you're doing, it can be your friend. If you don't know what you're doing, it can very definitely blow up.
I can certainly see how that applies to the mayor.
You made that thing.
I need that point. You and then we'll come back to you.
I'm a little bit concerned about looking at the bigger picture, how we make decisions in society when almost, in a sense, it's kind of like mom rule, where we've taken, instead of people in the press room looking over stories and sitting back and thinking about how to do their effect all, including my friends and the people I follow who follow me, who guide my attention. So, and that worries me. And the location where this is happening is mainly urban environments. That worries me. At, you know, Tahrir Square, what happened in Egypt was, you know, the people tweeting and Facebook, and these are all in urban environments where the vast majority of the people in Egypt are very poor and possessed.
And they don't have any
access. So I'm worried about participating in democracy and what kind of an impact this has on democracy. And let's look at an issue, for example, mining. I would have to take this clue about what goes on in mines, but I'm very, very worried about that. Some guy earning $45,000 a year driving Canadian mining policy, even though, yes, it's an area that needs improvement. But who am I? I don't believe I'm not educated in this area. And most people in cities aren't. 45,000 people complained against this, we've got to shut it down. I'm just wondering whether we should be more smart about
it. It's a very good point, but I can give you the opposite side of the same coin, which is that governments are smart enough to understand where their voters are too. And although this is a terrible example, which I don't want to use, I'm going, and the example is what's happened in Quebec recently here with their secular charter. They know exactly who they're talking to. And they're talking to people outside of the island of Montreal. They're talking to people where they can win 40 or 45 seats. And that's where their focus was. The fact that they may not be successful in that is a different issue. But they actually got it. So you don't always have to worry. I mean, governments are prone not to be all that. They're representative when they add up the number of seats that they need to win. That's the representative part of their mandate. But in that case, they can get 10,000 tweets and social media messages from people outraged, whether it's in the island of Montreal or whether it's in Toronto or some other part of the country. But they don't care because they're actually looking at how we play in the audience that they want. But it's a very good point, and it's what journalists worry about. Although, to be fair, I'm not sure that all journalists have the capacity to make those kinds of assessments. I think the beauty and the value of social media is you actually hear a cacophony of voices, and that is good, but it's then being able to apply judgment, which has never been, in big supply anywhere. That's the real issue. And that's the toughest part. Yeah.
Just to kind of expand on what I said before, and just turn on things about content.
Right.
It just seems like social media, especially something like Twitter, is just being used constantly as a reactive process rather than proactive. It's just something like any of it. How President Obama dealt with it, it's reactive. Something has happened, how do they react using social media?
Not necessarily.
Where's the can
you give you a perfect example? Obama wanted, back to my words about fulfillment and engagement, mm-hmm. Obama would continually use the social media platforms that they had established to get people to do things. And those were not reactive. Those were proactive activities. We want you to go and tell your neighbors the following four things. We want you to do this. This was totally not reacting to some story that had occurred. It is absolutely true that often people react to the things that are happening, but people also use social media to create news. And politicians are among the first to be able to get out there and do it. So I just want to say that it's not just the one way street, it can be both ways.
I think that's true, but I think that it's one of these things where social media, that one of the defining characteristics of it is stupid. And with respect to that, where it's particularly dangerous and where it's particularly applicable is once something happens. So you can use social media in a proactive way. You can use it. That's why I brought up the example of McDonald's, where they had, let's talk about our food. Now, they didn't wait, well, I could have been hit for years on it, but since they said, well, let's not just wait for another attack. Let's just have a quote-unquote honest discussion where you ask us a question, and we'll give you an answer. That was an example of a kind of a proactive approach. But generally speaking, where social media is used, it's X as it's a fan, and then it spreads like wildfire, and someone put it in a reactive position. So the challenge is to use a message that works particularly well, like a contagion.
It took us a while to create the point for us to mind what's happening with these two. So now, we looked at how the Obama administration ran the second campaign. The kind of data, the sophisticated data mining tool that they looked to, they created to segment the population to figure out who wants what and who's talking about what. I think we've finally arrived at a position where these tools have reached a kind of maturity where you can, if you wanted to, do proactive things by firstly gathering intelligence about what does a particular segment of the population.
give you enormous capabilities in being able to understand where you want to focus your messaging and to whom you want to do it. Anyways, I think that I probably have with my welcome, so thank you very much. You didn't know. So it should be, but he'll be very moderate.